back by popular demand.
Thank you, Father.
very happy to have you. Hey, I'm Father Mark Mary.
I'm Mother Clare.
We are the Franciscan Friars and Sisters of the Renewal, and this is Ascension Presents. We had this experience recently that you never would imagine happening, of not having access to Mass. And so we're going to talk, Mother's going to share a little bit about her experience of that in the convent, what she's learned, and how we can corporately learn from it and grow in Eucharistic love, devotion, amazement.
I will never forget the morning. It was March 22nd. I stood before the sisters before Mass, actually, to alert them to the fact that this might be our last Mass for the foreseeable future, just as things were unfolding. You could hear a pin drop. I mean, the shock, the solemnity, the intensity of what that meant. We live with the Blessed Sacrament. We were never without it. The tabernacle with our Lord present. Our good priest consecrated many, many hosts for us. So we're so blessed, and we recognize that. But the Mass is different. It's different than just the reception of the Eucharist, to be present for the offering of the sacrifice. And I just stood there and I said these words that I never imagined coming out of my mouth, and the stunned silence of the sisters. And we participated in that Mass like we have never participated before, with the fullness of our mind and our heart and our attention and just with everything, you know, which is a good thing. It's a win that we did that all the time. And I think that's what it produced in us, this profound gratitude. And I know for myself, my mind went back to so many Masses and how attentive really was I, how grateful am I truly, how have I taken this for granted? You know, we have such accessibility to the sacraments, but boy, you know, am I as grateful as I should be? I would have to say no. But I would have to even say good for us in a way, mm-hmm. to go through that. And what our whole, so many of the faithful are still in that situation right now. So we, you know, have to be very empathetic to that loss. It is a loss.
It's really, really common in a sacristy for there to be a little note that says, like, priest of God, celebrate this Mass if it was your first Mass, your last Mass, and your only Mass. That's a good place to try and journey towards, is each and every time we're partaking in the sacrament of the Eucharist, to really prepare ourselves and to really enter into mm-hmm. what we're doing, and to sort of, I think a lot of, on the friar side of things, like, I am a priest, right? So I was never without the sacrifice. But one of what we were trying to do is, let's grow an appreciation for what this gift is. In all things, God is at work for the good of those who love Him. That it's a tragic time for so many of the faithful to be apart from the Eucharist, but God's going to enter into that and trying to bring good out, like it sounds like He did with the sisters. And this intentional growth and devotion and attention to how grateful I am for this gift in my midst, including the participation of the sacrifice.
Well, I mean, the Eucharist has always been the center of our prayer and our spirituality. We are certainly a Eucharistic community, yeah. without question. But for me, I think just stopping to think about, first of all, the difference between receiving the Holy Eucharist, which is a blessing and a consolation and a gift, and being present at the Mass, and that these are two distinct things. And that was important for me because I felt there was a difference the minute I was receiving, but not at the Mass. I was like, what is this difference? And that the offering of the Mass is something particular and unrepeatable, its own sort of mystery, which we could do another show on. But what I felt the Lord asking of me in that was to learn how to make myself the offering. What is it to live a Eucharistic spirituality in my life, in my flesh, to give myself to the sisters? And we had sisters who were sick at that time, and there were three of us who were well in our convent and three of us who were very sick and behind closed doors of isolation. And so the reflection really was, how do I become broken and poured out for them? How do I learn to become the offering, you know, and to live a Eucharistic life? So that was the first and the deepest thing, I think, that the Lord maybe wanted to teach me, how to live that in a concrete, daily, and ongoing way with the people with whom I live. And then certainly gratitude, you know, just to, the gratitude just flows forth naturally. And the repentance, that is a word I have to say, because I felt the need to repent of the just the ingratitude, the not thinking, the thoughtlessness with which I've certainly lived out my life at times, you know, to not be grateful enough, to not think enough about the meaning of this, and to really, truly, and sincerely repent of that. And it was a great opportunity to do that. And then just to be with the Eucharist, because again, this is where our life is very different from the lay faithful. And I feel great sympathy and empathy for the lay faithful who do not have a tabernacle in their home. And so we were never without the Eucharistic Lord. And so we were with him as much as we possibly could. And right away from day one, even before the masses were suspended for a time, we increased our holy hours just to intercede for the world. We said, well, we can't do in activity and ministry what we once did, but we can pray, and we better be praying, you know? And so we started doing a 3 o'clock Eucharistic holy hour and the Divine Mercy Chaplet explicitly for the intention of the world, for the end of the scourge of the coronavirus for the world. So in our house, we were actually doing 3, 4, and 5 o'clock holy hours every day, which normally in our life, we do a 5 o'clock holy hour. So this is, of course, an increase there, which is beautiful, mm-hmm. to just enter into the intercession. Intercession and solidarity were big words and themes for us during that time.
For a lot of people, they felt very deeply and acutely and painfully the absence and the separation from the Eucharist. We realize that when this video is coming out, different people, different places, different dioceses are at different points. So maybe you're able to return to Mass again and pray in churches, maybe you're not. But if you have really felt the suffering, I think what your sisters did is a great example, is can we use that, mm-hmm. right? Can we use the suffering and to be renewed in repentance for ways in which we have been indifferent toward the Eucharist? If you're not in the habit of visiting the Blessed Sacrament during the week, can you try and find a time, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 30 minutes, just each week to go and spend a little extra time with the Eucharist? You can sort of be creative in it, but some sort of amendment of life, some sort of act of, okay, I want to continue to experience and to grow my death, my love, my reverence for the Eucharist. And so just to step up some sort of devotion. I think it's a great, mm-hmm. great practice and a great way to bring about some good through the suffering. But secondly is this, and as mothers, as you shared, is some people don't feel it on an emotive level. Mm-hmm. And there might be a temptation towards like guilt that maybe they don't feel the absence, they don't feel the longing. What would you say to those people?
So the first thing I say is there's no shame in how you feel. And you really can't control how your initial reaction to something. So just to let go of that sense of guilt. And then secondly, what we do with those emotions is just submit them to our mind, submit them to our faith-filled reason. You know, we know, we believe, I think the people watching this are believers in the real presence in the Eucharist. So we submit that feeling then to our mind that knows, and we increase our faith, we exercise our faith. And what happens is slowly the heart catches up to the mind in these areas, and to not feel too bad about it. You know, but just to exercise the mind, exercise the faith, and then really exercise the will then through the actions, like you're describing, Father, the renewed devotion, which is, of course, an act of the will. The increased visits is a choice that we make. And these things, you know, allow our heart to sort of then catch up to the mind.
Yeah. I am doing what I'm doing because of the Eucharist. Mm. And it's the central, in many ways, central gift, mystery, defining movement of my life. And we know that there's some wavering, there's some doubts about this, but it's a great opportunity for us to evangelize the world and to give witness to the reality of the Eucharist as the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus by really living a renewed life of Eucharistic amazement and devotion. I just remember sort of, maybe as a sort of a closing sort of story, is being at a cloistered nuns convent and how moved I was by the way in which the sisters received the Eucharist. Mm. And it impressed on my heart. I was a novice at the time, but like their love of the Eucharist renewed me in love of the Eucharist. And it's like the way they looked at Jesus remind me of who he was. Mm. And so for us, it's a great opportunity for us to renew Eucharistic devotion and faith in the church by really entering into our love of the Lord and just and looking at him with amazement.
Yeah, and renewed love. Well said, Father. Thank you. That's what it's all about. Meaning of our life.
Amen. So, Mother, thank you again.
My pleasure, Father.
Thank you again, and thank you guys for being with us. And Mother will be back again soon. So some of your prayers have been answered. And just a reminder, we're pilgrims on this earth, little by little. Poco a poco, vamos a llegar. We're going to make it. Thank you so much. Praying for you. We'll see you next week. God bless you.